Hey everybody, welcome back to the channel. 2 months ago, I shared the oil pressure loss demonstration video showing oil pressure drops on track with two minimally modified FA24 cars. These cars had Jackson Racing oil coolers, stock suspension with just minor front camber adjustments, and low grip GT radial Champiro SX2 tires with no other modifications to the engine or oiling. A month and a half ago, I shared the results of our Killer Bee prototype baffle test, which didn't show a meaningful improvement, unfortunately. Since then, there have been a handful of additional people in the community who've instrumented their cars and been able to reproduce pressure drops on track, including one person with an FA24 without an oil cooler. I'll include that at the end of this video and link to some of the other folks' videos in the description. Today, I'm really happy to report that we have a new test scheduled for this weekend and that I have a brand new prototype baffle. This one is from Verus Engineering. In the rest of the video, I'll give you some insight into the development process for this baffle and our plans for testing it. After our last test was unsuccessful, we needed to take a step back to figure out what to do next. If you look at the comments from my first two videos on this topic, you'll see two very common suggestions: add an accumulator or do a dry sump conversion. Many go as far as to claim that there is no solution short of a dry sump. These are good suggestions, and a dry sump would almost certainly solve the issue, but there are a number of reasons why I think it makes sense to first try to find or develop a baffle that can solve this issue, at least on low grip tires. The way I'm thinking about it is a baffle, maybe combined with a moderate overfill, is kind of like stage one, minimally invasive and accessible to the greatest number of people. Stage two is an accumulator, ideally paired with a baffle so the accumulator doesn't have to do as much work. And stage three is a dry sump. In case you're not familiar with dry sumps, I'll give a quick overview. Instead of allowing oil to pool at the bottom of a sump, as in a wet sump, a dry sump employs multiple scavenge pumps which transfer that oil into a large reservoir. The pickup providing oil to the engine draws from this reservoir. These reservoirs are really big, typically, 10 quarts or more is not uncommon. You can find these in race cars and NASCAR and performance cars for the street, like Porsche GT cars, among others. They're really robust, but they're also complex and expensive. You have to worry about things like de-aerating the oil in the reservoir, since the scavenge pumps are often sucking in air and additional oil. And in order to do a retrofit, you're looking at typical costs on the order of $10,000. You usually have to make sacrifices as well, like often you have to eliminate the AC pump in order to power the scavenge pumps. This, of course, means that you won't have air conditioning. And while these retrofit kits are available for the FA20, I'm not aware of any that are commercially available for the FA24 yet. Accumulators, on the other hand, are much less expensive and less invasive. They involve a reservoir of oil that's forced into engine oil passages whenever the oil pressure drops below a configurable threshold, let's say 40 psi. These are commonly added to track cars, and the Lotus Exige, track-oriented though it was fitted with an oil accumulator from the factory. But accumulators come with their own trade-offs. They add failure points, maintenance burden, have a limited capacity, which is usually around 2 to 3 quarts of oil. The accumulator needs to be refilled from the engine's pressurized oil passages, unlike a dry sump, which refills from lower pressure areas after the oil has been circulated through the engine and used for lubrication. So there's a risk that when you're refilling the accumulator, you could be reducing the pressure to the bearings at a time when you really want maximum pressure. Like, let's say you have a pressure drop in a corner and the accumulator dumps its oil to compensate. Then you exit the corner at full throttle and the accumulator starts refilling itself when you really want maximum pressure. Another nuance with accumulators on Subaru engines is you typically need a switch to activate and deactivate the circuit from the engine to the reservoir. This is because at idle, you're typically only seeing 15 to 20 psi of pressure once you're up to operating temperature. This is definitely going to be below the threshold that you've set for the accumulator to dump its oil into the engine. So unless you're able to close that circuit, you're going to dump the entire capacity of the accumulator into the engine, leading to a 2 to 3 quart overfill. The risk here is that you submerge the crankshaft in oil and it starts frothing or aerating the oil. This will dramatically reduce its ability to lubricate the engine. So to avoid this, there are typically two approaches. One, you can fit a manual valve that you can shut off anytime you might have low pressures. So some people will flip this switch when they go on the track and then flip it off when they leave the track. The only problem is now you have a human in the loop and humans make mistakes. Personally, I'm not really comfortable with that risk. The other approach is an electronically operated solenoid valve. You can do really fancy stuff with this, like observe the engine RPM through the CAN bus and only open the circuit above 4000 RPM. It's probably the direction I would go, and it's actually what my friend Miles is doing with an AccuSump that he's installing on his FA20. He's the one with the black 2017 Subaru BRZ from my first video. There's still a catch though. Solenoid valves used in this way have a reputation for somewhat high failure rates. So there's still a risk of an accidental overfill if the circuit is stuck in an open position. So you can see that there are some trade-offs involved with both of these approaches, whether that's money, complexity, reliability, or human error. A baffle, in contrast, is a really simple device. Most have no moving parts. The ones that have moving parts, those moving parts are very simple. They don't require any maintenance, and they don't require human intervention. They're relatively cheap as well, usually just a couple hundred dollars plus installation. So enter the Verus Engineering prototype baffle that I'm now preparing to test. I can't show the baffle publicly yet, but I can talk about it. So the design philosophy was a collaboration primarily between Verus and one of my friends here in the Bay Area, a mechanical engineer and GR86 owner. I'd like to give you some insight into the design philosophy and development process for this product. After finding ourselves at a dead end with the theory that the gap to the timing cover was the culprit, we started to reassess our priors and looked back at track footage. We knew that we needed to go in a different direction, we just didn't know what direction it was yet. So there were a couple different theories that were top of mind. One is insufficient oil return due to oil pooling in the heads. On flat engines like the FA24, you have a head on each side of the crankshaft. These house valve trains and require oiling. It's possible for oil to pool in the heads, and this is a bigger problem in flat engines than in inline engines, where you have gravity going straight down into the sump. It's also a problem for other manufacturers, like Porsche's M96 engine. Porsche eventually mitigated this issue with oil scavenge pumps in the heads, but retrofitting scavenge pumps in the heads is tantamount to open heart surgery. It's very invasive and very expensive. While studying on-track video, we also noticed some of the oil pressure drops weren't really consistent with this theory. Normally, you'd expect to see pressure drops from insufficient return after some delay, like in a sustained corner. But turns like 5 West at Thunderhill showed this problem almost immediately upon turn-in. So we decided that this was, one, a very difficult theory to solve for, and two, possibly not the most likely cause of the pressure drops in the first place. The next theory was windage from the crankshaft. At higher RPM, the crankshaft is rotating over 120 times per second. This rotation displaces air, and that air can potentially displace the oil in the sump. On the FA24, Subaru added some integrated baffling into the upper pan designed to block this effect, but we weren't really sure it was sufficient. And the last and most simple theory is oil slosh. The idea is that as you corner, lateral acceleration forces oil away from the pickup. A force of 1G will displace a liquid to a 45 degree angle. But in the engine, the forces are even more dynamic, so the effects can be greater. The offset location of the pickup would explain why we only really see pressure drops in one direction in right-hand turns. So we think this could also explain why the pressure drops can be seen in certain corners very quickly as well. There are several members of our local track group who have already installed baffles that attempt to reduce slosh. No Street Racing 86 on YouTube has the Sims baffle, and Track and Build has the Tome baffle. We've seen these to reduce oil pressure drops somewhat, especially on flat corners, but not really enough to recommend them. Both of these baffles use primarily horizontal surfaces to try to reduce slosh. In the comments on a previous video, several people suggested that we check out a baffle from a company in Japan called Kazama Racing. This baffle uses a vertical partition with a one-way trapdoor to allow oil near the pickup but not to escape away from it. But my friend, the mechanical engineer, he saw some features in the horizontal surface that he thought might inhibit oil return. So he took the initiative to start modeling his own solution. He bought an oil pan and combined the ideas of a vertical partition with more intricate horizontal detailing. He ended up producing CAD models of a potential solution, And then he got in touch with Verus and they agreed to help develop a prototype. They went back and forth extensively and Verus contributed their expertise as well as 3D scans of engine internals and their own pan in order to ensure good fitment. So what we're about to test is the result of multiple thousands of dollars of engineering effort by multiple parties. And I really want to thank my friend and Verus Engineering for all the work that they've put into this, regardless of what the result is. This week, I'll be getting the baffle installed, and then I'll be back testing at Thunder Hill over the weekend. I'll be removing the Killerbee prototype baffle as well as the pre-filter in order to provide a clean slate for this test. We've also purchased the Kazama baffle, and No Street Racing may be testing that out in the future. Thanks to Apexi USA for providing a discount for us on that product. And finally, I want to thank the community for all the support, theories, ideas, and messages. I'm planning to do a video in the future addressing many of the questions I've received, but I've also tried to answer as many of them as possible in the comments and have addressed actually some of those comments in this video. Also, I've mentioned this before, but all this testing has been done entirely independently and self-funded. If you do feel inclined to help us cover our cost, which at this point are in the thousands, I've opened up a PayPal donations page and I'll link to that in the video description. Any contributions would be really greatly appreciated. You can also subscribe to this channel for future updates and find me on Instagram at 900BRZ for an even earlier look at the results. Thank you and wish us luck.